I was born in Erzincan in eastern Anatolia. Three brothers. I'm the middle brother in a family with three children. My family had a very humble life. We were a middle-class family. Most of my education and my growing up happened in Ankara. My father was a public servant. He was the head of the Turkish forecast division in the Turkish Meteorological Service. My mother was a housewife. She had very little education, but she was a very clever person. She read a lot, both at my high school and at my university. I liked reading a lot. My mother tells me that I used to read, in Turkey, packages are done with newspaper, old newspapers. My PhD education at Stanford was very intense. I did modeling of interactions between high energy electrons and electromagnetic waves. I never looked back because I then did research all over the planet. My research group at one point had observations at 40 different locations around the planet.
Interested in the radiation belts that surround our planet and waves and particles that interact in that radiation belts. The particles in the first place come from the sun, solar wind for example. There's also some ionospheric sources, but they are then accelerated by various processes in the Earth's near space in the radiation belts. And these processes are electrodynamic processes. They involve large amplitude waves and high energy particles. So we measure the ways in which the particles are accelerated by making measurements of waves on the ground, on satellites in Antarctica, in Alaska, all over the planet. And we also measure particles. And we're trying to quantify and understand how this acceleration and loss occurs. My research is relevant to the everyday person. It has to do with the satellites that fly in near Earth space. More and more our technological society now is dependent on satellites. Your cell phone is operating because of satellites in many cases. So the satellites are affected by the radiation, high energy electrons and protons that exist in this near Earth space. And what we want to do is understand the sources and losses for this radiation. So we might be able to know and predict and possibly even control the radiation.
So my career at Stanford was very interesting and fruitful and was going upward at full speed when I was contacted by Koch University for the presidency of this fantastic university in Turkey. And at that point, you know, at Stanford, I basically had tenure, so I could continue working at Stanford until I die, apparently, effectively. I looked at this opportunity as a way to give something back to my country. Because when I graduated from my high school, this country presented to me the Middle East Technical University, which was a fantastic university, that then enabled me to do a fantastic undergraduate education. I could have worked longer at Stanford and graduated more students and did more scientific things, but I thought I should also give back to my country. And I returned to Istanbul after 36 years. I was away from Turkey for 36 years, and I returned in September 2009 to become president of this university. It was a very interesting transformation. I also turned the university to a research university that is active in all of its schools and departments, and the newest of which was the medical school and the hospital that was built after I came, which is now the best hospital in Turkey. And scientifically, we are at the cutting edge of medical research and research in other schools. Koch University provides full scholarships to 40% of its students. So we bring students from the depths of Anatolia, extremely poor students who have no family wealth or income, can come to this university and study at this university and prepare for enormous contributions to Turkey and to the world.
Sevgili mezun adaylarımız, bugün üniversitemizin 25. mezuniyet töreni için bir aradayız. Bu güzel ve anlamlı günde aramızda olduğunuz için ne mutlu bize. Hoş geldiniz. Sizler bu kampusa yeni geldiğiniz yıllarda, yani yaklaşık 4-5 sene evvel, yüksek hayallerimiz ve heyecanlarımız vardı. Hızla gelişmekte olan üniversitemizde yeni akademik yapılar için izin alabilmek, kaynak bulabilmek ve bu yeni binalarımızda oluşturacağımız yepyeni teknolojik laboratuvarlar, sınıflar ve çalışma mekanlarımız sayesinde dünyanın önde gelen üniversiteleriyle yarışırken çok daha güçlü bir konumda olabilmeyi hedefliyorduk. Şimdi büyük bir gururla artık bu hayalimizi gerçekleştirmiş olduğumuzu ve bu yeni çalışma alanlarımızda geleceğimize ışık tutacak yeni araştırmaların kıvılcımlarının saçılmaya başladığını görüyoruz.
The research that I did at Stanford over 36 years involved the space that is around the planet Earth and its upper atmosphere. It's very interesting because the atmosphere, as you go higher in altitude, gets thinner and thinner. And at some point, the density of the atmosphere becomes so thin that the sun's rays and ultraviolet radiation from the sun ionizes the atmosphere. So the atmosphere, instead of being a neutral atmosphere where you can breathe, it turns into electrons and ions, an electrical environment. So in this electrical environment, it's called the ionosphere. And beyond this environment is the so-called magnetosphere. The magnetosphere is dominated by the Earth's magnetic field. And some of the most interesting physical things, physical processes take place in this region of the planet. So in my group, we studied everything from the clouds where lightning occurs with enormous electrical discharges, all the way up to thousands of kilometers away from the planet. Not all the way to the moon, but about halfway to the moon. All the electrical processes that follow. And in the course of these studies, we discovered that sometimes when lightning occurs below the clouds at 10 kilometer altitude, you have luminous displays of light at much higher altitudes. These higher altitude lights, they're called sprites. And then there's also another type of these lights called elves that occur at 100 kilometer altitude. Or 60 kilometer or 70 kilometer altitude, these are a result of the lightning that occurs at cloud altitudes. But it's because of the fact that the electrical field that is produced by lightning discharges the atmosphere at very, very high altitude. The reason it doesn't discharge at low altitudes is because the density of air is much higher. Once these things were discovered, we made all kinds of observations by bouncing radio waves from these conducting regions, by making optical observations at different wavelengths with cameras that are uniquely designed to measure these phenomena. And especially in the 90s in the early part of the 2000s, there was an enormous flurry of activity where we understood better the coupling of the neutral atmosphere and the ionized atmosphere of our planet. These were heretofore unknown, undiscovered effects, but was very exciting area of research. Probably 10 or 12 or 15 of my 60 PhD students worked on these things. And it was very enjoyable. Science is enjoyable because it generates questions. These topics, when you answer some questions, you have many more questions that come in front of you. So there's no end to it. You can study it until you die or until, you know, there's so many questions that you can't pursue. So the physical phenomena that occur under the influence of electric fields discharged by lightning in the presence of a magnetic field of the planet and in the presence of an atmosphere that is decreasing in density and becoming ionized as you get higher and higher in altitude. These topics are really extremely good examples of basic science. Basic science may or may not have applications in the immediate future, but it will have applications in 20, 30 years from now. So when we understand our atmosphere, when we understand the upper atmosphere, then we begin to understand the near-Earth space. And in near-Earth space, there's radiation. Radiation in the form of high-energy electrons, high-energy protons. And these high-energy electrons and protons determine the lifetime of satellites because satellite instrumentation is affected by this radiation. So when you begin to understand the ups and downs of radiation fluxes in the Earth's magnetosphere and ionosphere, then you a lot of our technological society now is dependent on satellites that fly in these regions, and the satellites are affected by the high energy electrons. And the sun has enormous storms, for example, solar wind comes from the sun, hits the Earth's atmosphere, makes the fluxes of electrons and ions go up. That affects the satellites, and that then people have to take into account in designing satellites, designing them for a certain lifetime, to take into account the radiation levels. It's basic science, and it's curiosity-driven science. Every one of my students, when they started their PhD thesis, they were pursuing a question that they came up with together with me. And in the end, they answered that question by modeling or by making a measurement. But they also revealed many other questions. That's the beauty of basic science. I had heard about the Mustafa Prize back in 2015 when it first got started. And I was very pleased to see that there's a prize that is a prestigious prize for Islamic scientists in Islamic countries. when I heard this a few weeks ago, that I was chosen to receive this prize this year, it was a very pleasant and humbling surprise for me. I was honored and humbled to receive this prize, but it was a complete surprise for me. I think that countries such as Iran and Turkey and other countries in this region have enormous potential for the future from the point of view of scientific contributions and industrial contributions. I think to unleash this potential, what we need to do really is to let young minds do what they want to do. Need to create the free environment for people, bright people, to pursue their own ideas. Very often, the mistake that is done is to gather a lot of very bright people and then try to govern these people, try to tell them what to do, try to write programs so that they follow step by step this program. Following step by step somebody else's program limits progress, because what we should do as leaders of countries, leaders of industry, is to establish a free environment and then let people thrive in this free environment. We need to protect the free environment. We should not tell people what to do. We should follow people. Once we get the right people, then we should let them be. And provide them the resources, provide them the support. And if we create this environment, then magnificent things will happen. I strongly believe this. I'm trying to do a model of this at my university. And I see that it is successful. And I think that more and more institutions in countries in this region should pursue these ideas. As we look at the future, I think of my family. I have two beautiful children. I have three beautiful grandchildren. And I think that for a future world that allows them the best environment in which they can thrive, we must make sure that people with ideas can pursue their ideas. I'm grateful to my family. I'm grateful to my parents for all their support. I'm grateful to my wife for her enormous support of my career. I'm grateful for my children because of the incredible pleasure that they have given me all my life. I have two girls and one boy, and they are both enormously pleasurable. And I enjoy greatly playing with them. I enjoy greatly interacting with them. And when I look at them, I see my future. I see the country's future.